Welcome to this video about reading Python code. We will use the example GPIO code from the Raspberry project. You see here we have the main site for the project, and the code we'll be looking at, you may find it here. So in order to pull the code, we'll have our terminal on our Raspberry. Let's do a clear, and we have this. We take the code and put it into the Raspberry, and you will see that it's cloning, and now we've gone into the Raspberry directory. One of the hints we have here, which is relevant here, is that we have something called pins on the Raspberry, and whenever we talk about pins, we're talking about these. This is for the models A and B, and on the documentation side it says which pin number is assigned, which physical pin is connected to which pin number. They are not logical, so always check up on this. Okay, back to the code. We are in the Raspberry GPIO directory now. I can do an ls to see that we have four files. I can maximize this one. We have a readme and a read pin and so on, just to show you the readme file. Yes, this is a collection of simple Python scripts. Yes. And this is basically testing stuff. So when we attach a motor, we will have the run motor thing. Toggle pin is used to make LEDs, for example, blink. This is really fundamental output pin testing. And read pin is the same, just where you read an input pin. So let's go through the readpin.py program. I'm using nano for all these things. You can use whatever you want. Okay, so the way to read such a Python program here, as you can see, there's some lines of code here, blah, 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 blah. It is 68 lines of code. The way to read it is to, first of all, ignore the first lines where it says import. This is a function definition. Let's ignore that. More functions, more functions, more functions. And then we get to the part down here. This is the this is how the actual program gets run, where you basically this part here, that's a function that handles the command line arguments and dumps it in something, in a parameter called, in a variable called config, and then we do the read pin with appropriate parameters. So you could read this as a program that takes some command line arguments and reads a pin based on it. Is that enough for you to use this program? Most definitely, in most cases. You might even not go this far. We could try to run it on the command line. Too few arguments, and then let's do a pin number. This is this might be enough for you just to use the program, but you could go into more and more and more details if this is what you want. I'm trying to tell you how to read a Python program, so in this case you will not just use it as a program, we will actually try to understand how it works. You notice I did the Control C thing here. It will show up in the code later. So, down to the very bottom. Are we interested in how command line arguments are handled? Or are we interested in how to read pins? Well, let's do the hand command line arguments. It was the very first one. This one just sets up the command line arguments basically, and uses something called argparse, which is something it gets from Python. I have never looked into this one. It just works nicely for me, so I just use argparse and all this as black box, and I followed a guide on how to do command line arguments. And then we return whatever the result was. We then use this result to put it into the function called readPin. And this readPin is I've tried to make these functions very simple. This function sets up the GPIO, then it has some guard stuff. Try and accept that's advanced stuff. Don't think about it. Just see it as it calls the print pin value loop, and then it cleans up. So this function, it sets up the GPIO, starts the loop, and cleans up the GPIOs. If we need to know more, we can dig into the print pin value loop, which is here. So the pin value loop is a loop that will loop forever, and it will output something, and it will read the input pin. And that's what this program does. So the takeaway from this is we have some configuration and we use it to call a function called readPin. Semantically speaking, readPin is very understandable. And then if you decide that you want to know more, you can look into readPin and see that it sets up the GPIO, it starts the loop that prints the pin value, and then it cleans up the GPIO. If you want to know how it sets up the GPIO, you can look in this function. If you want to know how it cleans up the GPIO, you can look in this. And if you want to know how to print, how this loop works, you can look into this function. This is an interesting structure that we just have very, very specific functions for everything, which makes it very, very readable. I will show the almost exact same thing with the toggle pin program. Toggle pin takes some arguments, and for example a pin number, and it will just toggle the pin on and off. So if we look into this program, we ignore all the import part, we ignore all the function definitions, and then we have the exact same structure as before. We have some function that returns the configuration given on the command line, and then this gets used to call a function called toggle pin. Let's look at this toggle pin function. Toggle pin takes two parameters, the pin number it needs to toggle, and the wait time, which is the time in seconds between toggling. And then we set up the GPIO, we start the toggle pin loop, and then we clean up the GPIO. This try except is all about catching the control C. Always included, this is advanced stuff, so I don't recommend you thinking too much about it. Just like the import things we have here at the top, don't think about it. It's just enough to know that I'm using the GPIO module from somewhere else. This is something that is bundled with the Raspberry, so if you want to dig into this, then it will start to be hairy. Okay, so toggle pin, sets up the GPIO, it starts the loop, and it cleans up the GPIO. This setup GPIO, it's sets the GPIO mode. It has two modes, it's the BCM we use. And then it sets up that the whatever pin it got, it should be an output pin. And when we clean up, we actually just rely on a function called cleanup, which releases the hardware and so on. This is again black box thinking. Just you need to do it, otherwise you get warnings. Okay, so and then the toggle pin loop gives you, it's here. Oh, let's do like this. And then you see we have, this is some variables, that means data that we put some values into. This construct loops forever. We output something, we set the output to whatever we decide. We sleep fart, we wait, and then we update these two variables because we actually need them for the output. This is actually a way of toggling. It's very cool. And we have a counter so that we can see we actually have progress. Let me show you that again. The 0, 1, 2, 3, that would be this count variable that gets incremented every time. It makes it much, much more pleasant to see in order for you to understand what your program actually does. Okay. Anything else you want to say here? Notice that this handle command line argument, it is a very basic default Python library that you can just use. And if you look at something like this line, then you will see that this is how you add an argument. I don't know how it works behind the scenes. I just know that add argument like this gives me this wait time argument that I want to use. And I'm using it like this. So whenever I have a construct up here like this, we're going to end up being able to use it in the program by writing this. Some of this is advanced, but if you decide to just read what the function name says, think of functions as a box that does something specific, and sometimes it needs to have some extra values attached to it. That would be the parameters. And then it will behave slightly different depending on what the parameters are. Like in this case, if you give it a different pin number, it will toggle a different pin. Otherwise, it might just be a black box. Or if you want to know about it, you can start digging into toggle pin and look at it and see that it sets up stuff and so on. And then go into how it actually does the loop thing and so on. Python will give you a lot of error messages if you do stuff wrong. So you basically cannot break stuff by doing this. So just start playing with it, see what gives. I just want to show you the run motor quickly. That one has some difficult parts to it. As you can see, it actually has a lot more parameters already. And when we need to set up the motor GPIOs, you actually need to do a lot more. In order to understand how this motor GPIO works, you again need to look at the this part of the program and see that we get some configuration. We output something to the user, we run the motor, but you need to understand how on a hardware level we have a direction A and B, and we have some PVM and how frequency and speed works with that. When you understand that, then this program will be much easier to understand. So I suggest you look into this when you have understood the other thing. And I have tried to be very specific about these things. So like the others, it will loop forever. It will have some direction bits. It will either be idle or not. It will output something to the user. It will set which way the motor should run. It will say the motor speed. It will sleep, and it will do this counter thing again. So if you need to know how to set the motor speed, look at the function called set motor speed. And this will be something that, in order to do this is not something I invented. This is something I got directly from the Raspberry Pi documentation. But I have tried to have these three programs as example programs. So see if you can use them for something sensible. And if you cannot, just Google and do something else. But this is my take on how to make it readable. Thank you for listening.